Well, I want to thank everyone who told us online. I got these texts that there was no sound coming through. And so if you're online now, you got it right in the middle of the song, Ogie. You hit it, and now we're online. So I apologize. So everyone got to see Russ doing the introduction, moving around with a mask on, or without a mask, without sound. I'm sorry. Hey, next time, Russ, you got to do it again soon. So it's wonderful to have you here. And I want to ask Ryan, where are you? Ryan, I know you're out here somewhere. Come on down. And also want to ask Lily to come on forward. We have a few announcements. And I wanted to ask, what is going to happen this Sunday? So Lily, there you are. All right, very good. Come on forward. Let's find out what's going to happen. Let's give them a hand. And here's a microphone, Ryan. Excellent.
Hi, happy Sabbath, everybody. Such a beautiful day. So there was the consensus that we should do God's Closet again, because about half of them forgotten to come, or for whatever reason they were not able to come. I had somebody who said, I was not able to come because I had a car accident or some work related. So we're going to try to do this again. And a lot of them were very happy because, first of all, they were just so amazed that an event like this, we can pray for them, because they needed prayer. And they were really also needing the clothes, so they were really happy. We had a shelter of mom came. We had from the help group, which is a company that gives help to those who cannot afford. So we're going to come and do it again. And we have about 50 people to come again. Last time we had about 60 people come. And so we have a skeleton crew, but it's still going to work. So we want to just pray for that God will allow that to happen, because things are changing now.
So now, what is God's Closet again?
It's collecting children's clothing and giving them and distributing them to those in need at least quarterly. And so this is our second time. So we're going to see what the future holds.
What time is it?
9 o'clock is when the moms shop. And 30 minutes, they're given 20-30 minutes to shop, and then a group of people will come again at the 9:30, 10 o'clock, 10:30.
What day is it?
It's Sunday tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
6th
Very good.
December.
Excellent. And one other thing. We're all doing social distancing, right? And
yes.
Everything's appropriate, right?
Yes. The staff are wearing some face shield and masks, and everybody's told to wear a face mask, wash their hands, social distancing. Yes, it's amazing.
So now, if you have someone, or if you are someone that wants to come and be a part of this, or wants to, maybe you know of a family that is in need for this, they can come and get scheduled in between what time and what time?
From 9 o'clock to about 2.
So basically come from about 1 to 11, right? To make sure they get scheduled in so that it doesn't drain too late.
Right.
Good.
And I also want to give a very, very hearty appreciation to those who have given diapers. We have given diapers away to the families, and they were amazed. You know, even though a little bit can, it helps. I mean, I have mom that need 2 diapers for a 2-year-old and a 6-month-old or something like that. And we were amazed how that happens. We could not also do that without your help, without Baby to Baby Company, who said, yeah, we're not going to help you because you charge $1. But I said, we're going to consider not giving them asking them to pay the $1 because of COVID, you know?
Yeah.
So they decided to give us some diapers too. And then Glendale Academy families gave also some.
Yes.
So we're really excited and
Thank
happy
you.
That happened.
Thank you, Glendale Academy, and the families
and the
that
families
are helping
that
out
help
with this
out
too.
Here to give the diapers.
We want to thank all of those volunteers that are helping. Go ahead and clap. If you've been volunteering there, clap right now.
Yes.
Yes, those of you who've been volunteering, I want to thank you.
And we got, lots of pictures.
Yes.
So you're gonna show them, hopefully be in touch and in a website.
We'll see, but I know we've got Sunland Thonga, Livingstones, we got parents from Glendale coming and helping, and
yes,
praise the Lord,
definitely.
There's nothing like doing for someone that could never pay you back, but doing something that matters for someone else.
Praise God, yeah.
So, Ryan, and you're going to be there with the last, what do you do at the end?
So before they leave, I actually give them a word of prayer, and I was actually surprised how thoroughly blessed they are. Well, I'm not surprised, but at the same time, they never experienced that, a prayer during charity event like that. And, you know, it's a blessing for me as well, as I see them get closer to Jesus before my very eyes.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Let's give them another hand. And Lily, I have something for you. I will not remember if I don't get these to you. They're our address for church. So if people are interested, make sure you hold on to that for people that come tomorrow. So, because there are people that said, what? There's churches that are open? I said, yes, there are churches that, right? Right? So, praise the Lord. That was kind of a sad one there. Orvin, you were on, but, you know, there are churches that are open, right? Oh, yeah, and I see you here, and it's wonderful to have you here. And now is the time, let's throw up the graphic on the offerings. Hey, listen, we survive only one way, through donations. And I'll tell you that your every little bit you give, whether it be a lot or little, Jesus makes a miracle, okay? I just want to let you know, there's a graphic that's up here that is, it has the QR code for Livingstones and Sunland Thonga. Just, if you're on a TV, go ahead and put your phone in front of it. You can go right to the site. Or if you're on Facebook, right above my head, it's the first post on our site. And if you're on YouTube, you will see that there is a location there where you can go to our website, whether it be Sunland Thonga or Livingstones. So just remember, your church needs you. But now, here's the part. Your church needs you, but many of you and all of us need Jesus, right? It's time for the Garden of Prayer. So are you ready? When you get a chance, Christy, we're working out, and I'm going to go through the prayer list, if you don't mind. And then I'll be asking you, be ready for that, okay? And you guys can yell out your prayer requests. First one that comes up on my phone right now. Francesca, who was here last week? Raise your hand. That was amazing. Those of you who are online have no idea what happened, but there was an amazing event where a car literally went over a wall. I don't know how it happened, but truly, safety, God protected Francesca. And we're so happy to see you out there, Francesca. It was great seeing you. And you're getting an applause. There we go. Or should I say God is getting an applause. It was amazing, and God is so good. Also, we want to remember Vi, who had gone through a surgery, is healing from a hip replacement. I hope that surgery came. I haven't heard any words since the surgery, so just want to let you know, Vi, we're remembering you in our prayers. Lily has some prayer requests. There's Julio and Kathy. Julio and Kathy. Julio has been diagnosed with kidney problems. He needs dialysis, but it requires long-term kidney transplant. Okay, Romeo just texted me. For Alan in the ICU right now. Alan in the ICU. Romeo, we are hearing you, okay? Your family is important. I know you're at home with your family, and we love you guys, okay? Also, Flory's daughter, recently diagnosed with mild MS. So she's asking for special faith to deepen with the Holy Spirit. Also, Romeo asked for special prayer, extra prayer, that has to do with things that are personal to him and their family. So we want to remember that as well. Also, there is a family that we love, Anna and I, and Ryan and Lauren. We know of them very closely. We want to remember Reuben, and we remember you, Josie. We love you guys, and that God heal Reuben, and that God be with Reuben. Just stay strong, okay? Okay, Josie? Michael, Michael, who is asking for healing, had a large boil on his back, and a large one. And so it's been a cyst that's been getting smaller and smaller. He was going through a lot of fevers. And so Mike, hey man, we love you. Stay strong. I hope you're doing better, but it seems like things are going better. Praise the Lord. We want to remember also Alicia. And I know your brother Juan passed away just this last week. And we remember you in our prayers. And we look forward to seeing our friends and relatives and loved ones in an earth made new. Behold, I see a new heaven and a new earth, right? It says in Revelation. You know, sometimes we like to judge, or we try to find out whether someone's going to go to heaven or not. You know what God asks us to do? Let's not worry about that part. We know God is a good judge and Jesus is a loving God. So let's not worry. God has him in the palms of his hands. Also, I want to remember, Sergio, thank you for your text. Camila, we want to remember you in our prayers. Camila, little Camila. And also for your parents who are not feeling good right now. So just stay strong, okay? And just, you guys stay strong, okay? Also, we want to remember Elverine again one last time here. Elverine, who passed away over in Guatemala, and your family, and Orvin's family, all of them connected. We want to remember Mario and also his mom. We want to remember Esther. Now, there's a few Esthers. There's Esther, who is having a knee surgery or has had a knee surgery. We want to remember Esther and Ray, who have a son, Michael, that we love so much. And Esther also needs healing of her vocal cords. And also, Esther, another Esther, has the ankle that needs to be helped. So Esther and Andy, we remember you in our prayers. And Jacqueline always asks for prayer for health and guidance and financial security, as many people are asking for that. Want to remember you, Harold. Harold over there in Pasadena, he had gotten pneumonia, and he says it's mixed in with COVID. So he's a young guy, but Harold, that doesn't mean it's not scary. Stay strong, Harold, okay? I know you text me every little bit to see how you're doing. So want to remember Henny and her blood count always, and Gus as well. And we want to remember also Hernan. Mary at Sunlandanga Church has a son named Hernan who was hit by a car. His leg was broken. It was reset, but we want to ask for God to bring healing to him. Are there other prayer requests here right now? Right now is the time. Raise your hand if you want to say something, or we can do just a silent request. What do you think? You have a special prayer request? Not today. We're very shy today. Okay, raise your hand. Oh, wait, where's the hand? Ah, Cosette. Praying for rain. I agree with you. We need rain as long as it's not on Sabbath. Oh, sorry. We have a preparation for that, but as long as it's not Sabbath, right? But yes, we do need rain, and we want to remember those who are first responders right now, especially those dealing with the fires that are going on. There are a lot of people who have lost their homes, and it's an amazing month to lose your home. Man, it's hard. It's Christmas time. We also want to remember, Cosette, you remind me, just looking at you, we want to remember those in the Middle East right now, especially around Israel, and also Armenia, and all the things going on over there, as well as we want to remember Lebanon and the people. You know what? We sometimes disconnect from each other by conflicts around us. But then we realize that human beings, Jesus created all to be his children, everyone. And so we work together. We should not be separated. And in heaven, there will be no more social distancing, whether it be for health or whether it be because of prejudice and things of that nature. Jesus is the God of all. Do you have unspoken prayer requests? Raise your hand. And remember, if you put on Facebook prayer requests, I'm going to try my best to get to it, and we'll have it Tuesday evening, the call to prayer. Let's bow ourselves in whatever way you wish. Maybe your head, I'll be kneeling down here. So let's pray together and ask for Jesus to be with us. Jesus, thank you. We praise you and we love you. There are many people going through many difficult times right now. There are also many people praising you because of the joy they have with their families. But Lord, you see them all. You are the God who sees. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the opportunity to be able to know you. Now, Lord, we ask that you use the situations that are in our lives, whether COVID or not, or whether negative or positive, use all situations to wake us up so that we might be able to tell others about you, so that those people out there may have joy in their lives, separating themselves out from the life that hurts them and destroys them, not only their body, but their spirit and their minds. Lord, allow people, help us to be able to reach others. We pray also for this community around us, these houses to the north, south, east, and west around this church. And we ask that each person who's hearing right now be able to be given a blessing, and that the blessing may flow from this place. Be with Sunland Tahunga and Living Stones, our churches together as a team. Lord Jesus, we ask also you to be with our denomination and Christians in general, as well as our leadership in the country, in our churches, and also with our first responders, our police, the firemen, everyone, and all of those who have to deal with so many things at this moment. It is not fun, but thank you for people that are willing to give of themselves. Teach us to give. Not to take, but learn to give. We ask for all these things in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And now we end with a prayer you taught us to pray. Let's recite together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive those indebted to us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever, ever, and ever. Amen. Thank you. thank you so much. And Christy, thank you. And Gillian, you hadn't been mentioned. Thank you so much for doing such a great job. I know it's outside, you guys. You're doing a great job outside. So appreciate it. It's time to open our Bibles, right? But before we open our Bibles, I've got one of these San Pellegrino, a little advertisement, right? One of these San Pellegrino. These things are inside right now, your food boxes that you have. And you notice it has a top that's sealed, and we're going to unseal it, right? Unseal it. And then let's see if you can see here the, there, did you hear that? The crack, right? Right, now watch very carefully, very carefully. It's yummy. Well, it's seltzer water. Over in Europe, you get a lot of this. In America, people aren't as used to this, right? Imagine though, well, no, let's not imagine. When I used to live in Bangkok, Thailand, I used to order sometimes things like Vitamilk. I don't know, if you're from Asia, you know what that is. Or I would order like a San Pellegrino, Perrier, things like that. Or just water at the restaurant. And the person at the restaurant would come up and they would go and they would, in front of me, open it, and then pour it into the glass. And I'm like, wow, service deluxe, right? And my Uncle Jerry didn't say anything. Well, when I was with my Uncle Jerry, I went to a different restaurant. And that person just brought the water, set it down, but the top was already opened. You know what Jerry said? Don't drink it. We send it back. I'm like, I didn't realize. I was like, you know, I'm a new guy. I'm from the States. I'm going over there in Bangkok, Thailand. I'm learning the culture. And I'm like, what's the deal with that? I said, Jerry, it's fine. I can drink the water. I'm not some kind of aristocrat. He says, no, John, no. You watch it be opened up. You know why? Because it could be from someone else's. See, when you're trying to save money, right? Sometimes businesses will, in many places, will fill things up and use whatever. Now, imagine if this San Pellegrino was unsealed for a long time. I was thinking of even having a Coca-Cola can. Have you ever had a soft drink that's been sitting wide open? Raise your hand if you've had a soft drink that's been opened up for a long time. What does it taste like? Does it taste good? And then imagine it's been open even longer than that. Huh? Maybe it has something floating on the top of it. Do you want to drink it? I mean, would you want to drink it? Seriously. Also, there could be diseases. Sealing is like a protection. Same thing with a document. When you have a document that's sealed, then it's unsealed and you say, wait a minute, you get your mail and it's opened. Have you ever had that before? Your mail's been opened. You feel that kind of violated feeling, a little tinge of it, but it's been opened. Something has happened and you don't know what. You don't know what's in it. You don't know whether or not it's clean. Remember that as we move through this text. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Lord Jesus, as we discover what sealed means, help us, Lord, to be able to be more like you through this, not because my words are important, but because you have a special message to change everyone here and everyone within the earshot of this program. Allow your word to come to light. In your name, amen. All right, do you have your Bibles here? Raise your Bibles if you have them. Or if you may have them on one of these guys, right? We're going to go to Revelation. Pastor John, you're going to Revelation? I think I'm one of the few pastors who've gone to Revelation during this whole pandemic. But let's go ahead and go to Revelation. And I'd like to go to a very awesome text. Ryan, you brought up this text last Sabbath. It's Revelation 7:11. How do you like that? Who here likes 7-Eleven? I'm a 7-Eleven guy. I love 7-Eleven. Now, this pandemic time has been a time where I haven't gone to 7-Eleven that much because I can't stand how long it takes to get anything. It takes me way too long, so I'm like, can we just end it so I can go back to my normal mode of transportation? But 7-Eleven is one of those places that is, no matter where you are in the world, it's kind of like the same, interestingly enough. No matter where you go in the world, it's kind of like the same. I mean, the sizes and kind of the stuff that's there, but there's a general thing. And when we hit Revelation chapter 7, after 7-Eleven, we're going to move up to one text that will be the first wedge of the message, the first step into this message. I'd like you to move to Revelation chapter 7, verse 13. Verse 13, are you ready? Say amen if you're there. All right. What time is it right now? How am I doing on time? All right, very good. So, it says, when one of the elders asked me, now in the book of Revelation, John is in the middle of this vision and he doesn't know what's going on. It's weird stuff going on. And then there's 24 elders. All of a sudden, one of the elders comes to him and asks him a question. Then one of the elders asked me, these in white robes, who are they and where did they come from? Now, if you were in a weird situation where you have no idea what's going on, in an odd place, and then you're asked a question, what would your answer be? Dude, I have no idea would be my answer. But John says it in a different way. He says, and I answered, sir, you know. He's more proper, right? Sir, you know. Then this elder said, these are they who came out of the what? What? Great. I know, great tribulation doesn't sound like a big deal. But last night as I was translating the Greek, the words here for great tribulation are actually tes thelesios, tes megales. Now, you're like, what? That sounds like... But you heard one thing in there you do know. Have you ever heard the word of megales before? Godzilla versus Megalodon or Megalodon, whatever. In your computer, you probably have megabytes. Well, you might have terabytes now. But the reason why a megabyte was considered big is that was in the 80s when it was coined, because there were bytes. Bits and bytes, the small parts of information. And all of a sudden, a megabyte was huge. Now, I know we've got terabytes now. We got gigabytes and terabytes. But the megabyte was considered the largest bit of information back in the 80s when there were small amounts of information. Mega means immense, gigantic, and incredibly large. And the other word here is, here we go, thelesios, because it takes two words and crashes it together. It, thelesios, literally is like persecution, or it's like an attack. It's a siege. It can also be defined as, you can take it, levso is to go like this with your hands. Like this. Now imagine if you have something in your hands and you go like this with it. If it's a weak thing, it destroys it, doesn't it? If you take a rock and put it inside of a tumbler, you ever see these tumblers that make the rock smooth? It takes a lot of rocks and sand together, moving and moving. going thlefsu, thlefsu, thlefsis, megales, huge, trouble, difficulty. These are the ones, the elder says, who have come through the, who here has seen Toy Story? I know I'm dating myself. The big one. You ever heard of that? I love that when the kid comes out, the pain in the backside kid comes out with his racket and he goes, ooh, the big one. And he's gonna attach, of course, a toy to it and send it up into the sky, right? He was the guy that tortures toys. This is exactly what is referred to. And let me ask you, what is the big one in the Bible? I know a lot of us Adventists already know the definition of this. We say, it's the time of trouble at the end of the world. But I'd like you to actually redefine this for a second. When did the big war begin? When? In heaven, right? Actually, one of the generals of God, or the guy in charge of heaven, created a thing called a coup d'etat, where a general tries to take over heaven. Lucifer was his name. He was renamed after he was thrown out of heaven and after he took one third of the angels with him, or one third of the, basically the inhabitants of heaven with him. His name was renamed Lucifer, which means light bearer, became Satan, which means the accuser. Satan in Hebrew is to accuse or point a finger at, to accuse and judge guilty. He becomes Satan. This is the power. And earth had not become a part of this great war until, who was it that picked from the tree of knowledge of good and evil? I know the men are going to say Eve and the women are going to say Adam. But the answer is yes. They both picked from it, right? They both ate from it. They knew what they were doing. And at that point, the rebellion in the universe truly moved forward in this world. The universal rebellion that had happened now came to earth. At the same time, we see this kind of great tribulation throughout the Bible. We see mass extinction events. We see terrible things, one of them being the flood that happened. We see people who did terrible things, but they were on God's side. David, he made so many mistakes, and yet God said, this person's after my own heart because he wants to do what's right. Just because you do something wrong, does it mean you can't be on God's side? Let's move backward in the text. Now we'll get back to before 7:11. We're going to start with chapter 7, verse 1. Are you ready? After this, it says. Now this is in the middle, by the way, of all the seals in Revelation. After the sixth seal comes a group that's very interesting, and many people have speculated as to what it is. Let's see if we can define it today. After this, I saw four angels. They're standing, actually hovering is in the original language. So it's kind of like in the air, like this, with their wings out, kind of cool, visual. You know, you got to have that Avengers look, right? The four angels at the four corners of the earth, holding back the winds, the four winds on the earth. The earth to prevent any wind from blowing on the land or the sea or in any tree. Then I saw another angel, hetero angelos is the words, coming up from the east, having a seal of the living God. Remember what we talked about here, the sealed. Now I have another one that's sealed here. Which camera are we on? This one here, the seal is on it. I know it says San Pellegrino, but let's pretend it says the seal of God, right? And so having another seal coming up, remember, a seal, what does it do? It protects, right? From spoilage. Let me stop. This one is open. This one is damaged goods. I want to ask you a question. Are you damaged goods? Are you like David? Like Abraham? Like Hagar? Like Peter? Like Paul? Like John the Revelator, who are damaged goods? Are you someone that could never, ever, ever be a part of an awesome group of sealed, perfected people? Are you one of those that can't be a part of that group? Are you damaged goods? I'm going to ask you that question as we read. Because remember, sealing means protecting. It means undiluted. It means perfecto. Right? Clean, pristine, no opening, no viruses, no rancid, no darkness, only clean. As a young person, have you ever looked at yourself in the mirror and wondered why you look the way you look? Maybe you're a guy that isn't sure if you're good looking enough, or you do stuff that you wish you didn't do, have feelings you wish you didn't have. Maybe you're a female who looks in the mirror and wonders, why was I made this way? If only I do this, this, and this, and wear that, that, and that, maybe I can look the way I want to look. Maybe you say things to people you don't want to say and you hurt them and then you feel bad, but yet you continue doing it because if you say, I'm sorry, it's harder than changing. It's harder than just doing what you're doing. Have you ever been in that position? This angel comes from the east. He has a seal of the living God, it says. And he called in a megaphone, the words in Greek, megaphone, a loud voice, to the four angels who had been there and given power, he says, the loud voice of the four angels, who had been given power to harm the land, the sea. Do not harm the land, the sea, the trees, until a what? Seal is on the foreheads of his servants of our God. Then I heard. Now I want you to listen here. Then I what? I can't hear you. What did he say? Then I heard. What is he going to hear? The number of those who are sealed from the tribes of Israel. From the tribe of Judah, 12,000. From the tribe of Reuben, 12,000. From the tribe of Gad, 12,000. From the tribe of Asher, 12,000. From the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. From the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000. From the tribe of Simeon. I'm sorry, guys. You're saying, why in the world is this happening? I'm getting there. From the tribe of Levi, 12,000. From the tribe of Issachar, 12,000. From the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000. From the tribe of what? What's the next one? Joseph. Interestingly enough, poor Dan wasn't included in this. The tribe of Dan was up in the north. They fell quickly. But it says here, the tribe of Joseph, 12,000. And from the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000. Basically, what he's saying here is only Israel can get sealed. 12,000 from each tribe. So that's it. Only 144,000. That's it. Can you be a part of the 144,000? No way. You can't be. You know why? Because you're not pure. I remember when I was at a church that actually wasn't far from this place, someone comes up to me, it is an older gentleman, and he says, John, you know, I can't be a part of the 144,000. And I'm like in college, and I'm like, what's this guy talking about? You know how we Adventists are sometimes. What's this guy talking about? He said, when I had my heart valve fixed, it had pig that they use the heart valve, so I can't be a part of the 144,000. And I said, oh. You know, when you're in college, you're like, how do I respond to that? Praise the Lord, or what do you say? What do you say to something like that? You go, I'm sorry. But actually, I'm not sorry because you're alive. I did one of those things. And he says, that's true, I'm alive. And he walked on. He was like in his, I don't know, his 70s. And he was a really nice guy. He was just, you know, a little off sometimes. Good guy, though. And we all have the way we see everything should be sealed, the way it is, packaged. The company packages it. It controls it. The document is set. Everything is sealed. It's going to be this way. Only Israel. That simple. 144,000. Everybody else can go figure out what they're going to do, because 144,000 are in charge and are the best. But here's the wonderful thing about the Bible. Whenever something like that comes up, I had a professor over at Southwestern that always would say, John, keep on reading. He'd say, whenever you come to a place like that, keep on reading. You're going to find the answer. So, do you remember? I heard. Remember that? Are you ready? Are you with me? Have I put you all to sleep? All right, very good. I heard the names of the 12 tribes, right? And then something happens to John. Read the next words. After this, I what? I saw. I what? I can't hear you. I what? Saw. Now I want you to understand this. Imagine if you have your eyes closed and something is said. What you're going to look at is 144,000 people, and they're all from Israel. And in your brain, you start figuring out, you say, I know what that's going to look like. And all of a sudden, I turn and I see, and guess what I see? Take a look. I saw a great multitude that what? Nobody could what? Count from every what? Nation, what? Tribe, what? People, what? And language. Standing before the throne and before the Lamb, and they were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out before the Lord, salvation belongs to who? The 144,000? No, salvation belongs to God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb. And all the angels that were standing around the throne were all elders around the throne, and the four living creatures. They all fell down on their faces before the Lord, and they worshiped God. Amen, amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. To whom? The 144,000? No, to God. And then one of the elders asked me, these in their white robes, who are they? And John says, I don't know, sir. You know. And then the elder said, these are they who came out of the what? Great big one, the war. Like in World War II, you know what that was called to the old timers? My grandfather called it this, the big one. The war where everybody was at war, it seemed like. You had bullets coming from every direction in World War II. The big one. They came out of it and they washed their robes in the what? And made them white in the what? Blood of what? The Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. He who sits in the throne and the shelter in the presence, Never again will they hunger. Here's the 7-Eleven part. Never again will they hunger, nor will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them with scorching heat. And the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of what? What is living water? A few weeks ago, what did I talk about when we say living water? What was the word that I said? Joy, happiness. He's going to give them joy coming from inside them as a spring of life coming out. And God, what? Will wipe away. What's he going to wipe away? Every tear from your eyes. Did you notice I said your? Did you notice I said your? I have something to show you here. I enjoy George Lucas films. One piece here is, I don't know if you can see it here. Let's get it right over here. This is from Raiders of the Lost Ark, okay? I don't know if you remember the story, the Ark of the Covenant. They were there to search for the Ark of the Covenant, right? And there was a villain named Belloc, who then they want to open the Ark and see what's inside at the end. You remember that? Any of you might have seen it. If you're good Adventist, you shouldn't be watching these things, right? Just kidding. So he wears an entire high priest's outfit. And this is exactly what's on the breastplate. Do you notice the colors to it? There's yellow. There's red, yellow, black, brown, white. All our precious in is what? There's green, in fact, by the way. Do you see colors of skin tone in this thing? Do you see how Israel is all here? Judah, Gad, Asher, Naphtali. You see all these different stones and what they symbolize. Where is it when your high priest, where is it close to? Where is it close to, guys? Your chest. What's inside your chest? Come on. What's inside your chest? Your heart. Actually, if you go a little lower, it's also your bowels, which is where the seat of emotion is in Hebrew. This is the place when you get hit by a bullet, you don't want to be hit here. Here, usually they don't aim there. They aim here, generally. Because that, when you hit here, the person may die very quickly. I want you to imagine with me that when God says the names of each one of these tribes of Israel, I want you to imagine with me that when he opens his eyes and sees, he sees you. You are on the heart of the high priest who's in heaven right now. Jesus Christ, righteous. Whatever color you are, whatever background you have, and whatever language you speak, whatever tribe you think you're a part of, Jesus, he has you on his chest right now. He does not see Israel of old as his people. He sees Israel as his people. Does that mean the Jewish people aren't along? No, it doesn't. I want you to turn with me to Galatians, and this will be my last text. Galatians chapter 3. Are you with me? Galatians chapter 3. I almost lost all my drink, but while you're looking for Galatians chapter 3, I will get a drink. Cheers. Galatians chapter 3. I'm going to start with verse 23. And I was planning on actually reading more of this, but it's time. Time is short, and let's move on. So in verse 23 of chapter 3 in Galatians, Paul is writing, "Before the coming of this faith, We were held in custody under the law, locked up until faith was to come, which would be revealed. So the law was a guardian until Christ came, that we may be what? Justified by what? Faith. Now, that this faith has come, we are no longer under this guardian. It doesn't mean the law is unimportant. It means that the law is not that which saves. It's Jesus who connects with us. When we follow Jesus, we keep the law. It's that simple. And so, verse 26, so in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God. Through what? Are you there? Through what? Faith, ladies and gentlemen. You know who he's talking to? The Galatians he's talking to. He's talking to people who are pagan, people who are Greek, but he's also talking to Jewish people. It's not to omit Israel of old. It is that through faith we become Israel of God. Right? That's what Israel means. One who struggles with God. One who contends with God. You know, Israel, we are not perfect. But does that mean he has us any further from his heart? No. Actually, you and me are a part of Israel through faith. Let's keep reading. For you are all baptized into Christ. You have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free, male or female, for all are one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's child, seed. You are Abraham's child and heirs according to this promise. Are you with me? The basic message is this. When you believe in Jesus, when you live by his life, and when you follow Jesus wherever he goes, you are sealed. And though you may be corrupted sometimes, and you make errors and make mistakes, and though maybe there's a layer sometimes of moss over the top of your liquid in your life, huh? Jesus, when you ask, seals you and makes you brand new. The woman that was caught in adultery, Mary, who had made so many errors in her life, and she continued to. She had followed Jesus and then fell away. Followed Jesus and then fell away. And if Jesus was like most Christians and most people, when that woman was caught in adultery in the temple area, and they say, what should we do? She's violated the law. Moses commands that she be stoned. What did Jesus do? He says, he or she who is without sin, go ahead and cast the first stone. And then he proceeded to write the sins of her accusers down in the sand. One by one, the older ones left. And then the younger ones left. And then they were standing there all alone. And she says, now who condemns you? This woman says, no one, sir. I don't see anyone. Then he said, neither do I condemn you. Go your way. And in the text it says, sin no more. But let me redefine what that means. Not to make it softer, but to make it stronger. Go your way and reach for the stars. Reach for the stars. the reason why these stones are here are not because they're perfect stones. It's because the designer made them perfectly for the breastplate. The reason why you, when you give your life to Jesus, are a part of that 144,000 is not because you are perfect. It's because the designer made you perfect for heaven. Love you all, you guys. God bless. Happy Sabbath.
We thank you so much for the message. Lord, we thank you for your Sabbath. And Lord, help us to strive to be one of the 144,000. But Lord, most importantly, help us to just be in heaven, Lord. And we know that you are, it is your will, and you are in the business of saving us. So we thank you, Lord, and we are grateful for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. Now, everyone online, don't forget to like and subscribe. If you're on YouTube, if you share the little button at the bottom right down here, if you hit that little button to share it, you'll expand this channel, as well as if you you subscribe to the channel, you'll be able to get it every time something happens. Also on Facebook, if you're there, right above, like our channel, whether it's Sunland Tonga or Living Stones. May God bless you all. Have a great Sabbath, and we'll see you on Tuesday for the call to prayer. Bye-bye.